Hello and welcome to Queersay with me, Andrew Kay, and my guest, Bill Smith. Thanks for being here again, Bill.
Pleased to be here.
Love it. So it's been really very interesting, and actually I think I would like to ask you if you'd be a regular guest on the programme. I know you've done it once before, but I do think it's important that when we're looking at these stories, we don't always just look at them from a gay perspective. I think it's important to get someone else's view. And if anyone else would like to come in who isn't gay and is angry with what we have and what we do and what we talk about, then get in touch. I'd happily have you on the programme here, just so I can put you down. Let's look at our first story. Exclusive horse racing club opens its doors to LGBTI festival in India. Now, it sounds a bit of a silly story, this, on one level, but it is a massive mark of how much progress has been made in the Indian continent in the last 12 months.
I know, it is astonishing. India's not really been very out there, has it? So this is pretty shocking in a good way.
Well, most of my Southern Asian friends who I've talked to about being gay and being in India and Indian have talked to me about the fact that all the laws that they had to deal with were the hangovers from our imperial state in the past. You know, our Victorian values that we imposed on that part of the continent.
I think that's true in many ways, but it's quite easy to change the law, so it's also a bit of a cop-out, isn't it?
I mean, well, they could have been changed, yes, but let's face it, we took a long time changing them.
Yeah, about five millennia or whatever it is.
Yeah. It's not like we exactly post-Raj changed our views on homosexuality in the world.
It's good to see it happening, really. It's good to see it happening across the world, because as we discussed in the other show that we did, across the world there are so many bad stories. You know, Peter Tatchell, the famous gay activist, says that now the big fights really are across the world. International gay rights, international LGBT rights.
Well, as we know, he's tireless in his fight to change the global status.
Yeah, you should check his website and his blogs and stuff.
Yeah. They're fascinating.
They do. They keep you up to date with everything around the world, and most of it's not particularly brilliant. So to get a good story is unusual, and
I think it's wonderful. This is happening on the 27th of January.
We're going?
Get your checkbook out.
Where is it?
It's in Mumbai, and it's called the Gulabi Mela, which means pink fate, which is also lovely.
Yeah, nice name.
I just think it's wonderful now that these things are changing so that that oppressed community can actually come out of the closet. And for it to take place in something which is so... I mean, it's part of the upper class system in India, and there is still... the horrors of the caste system in that country. Let's wish them well with that. I think it's a great thing. And this is another great story. And I was aware of this bubbling away last year when I had two ex-members of the armed forces come in and talk about their path through the armed forces and striking out for LGBTI rights within them. But the Royal British Legion are launching a new branch for LGBTQ+ communities. Finally, recognition of the fact that a lot of gay people join the armed forces and exist within the armed forces on lots of levels.
Absolutely. You know, it's great that those sort of things stopping people doing whatever they want have been got rid of in the UK. The barriers, basically, to people's doing what they want have largely gone, and especially in the army, in the navy, in the forces. I'm not really a strong supporter of the forces, I have to say. But it's brilliant that people can do what they want. And, of course, it's great that the British Legion, who you just would not in a million years think would do this, are doing just what
you
described.
Well, the emphasis, of course, is on veterans. And it is acknowledging the fact that this isn't a modern thing.
Yeah.
This goes back a long way.
Yeah, how many years does it go back, do you know?
I don't know how long the British Legion.
Because a lot of people, of course, were probably veterans when you couldn't say you were actually gay. Does it include them as well?
Oh, yes.
It does.
And I think...
it's fantastic, then.
Really. It is fantastic. And I think it's, you know, we've been in denial about the fact that given that a lot of the forces existed in almost exclusively all-male environments, that strong relationships would not ever happen. Of course they happen.
There's those famous cases in Brighton of women who had to dress as men to join the army. I think one One famous woman is buried up in St.
She's
Nicholas.
Buried up at St. Nick's Church. Yeah, she was quite a character.
I can't remember her name, but yeah, I think you're right.
Something Temple?
I don't know. Yeah, yeah, we should find out and do a documentary, that's for sure.
Yeah. But I think this is really great. They're breaking down this barrier of marginalisation and saying, we have to acknowledge that this happened, this existed, there were relationships, and absolutely, they were loving relationships. Mm. I think that's wonderful.
I do too, absolutely. I think they're done, the British Legion.
And let's give them all the credit for this that we can.
Absolutely.
And make it publicly known, because I think there are a lot of people out there who would be very relieved to find that elderly members of their family that they often thought were perhaps gay and had strong relationships, they can talk about it and they can celebrate it.
Of course. I haven't been on before saying, well done, Royal British Legion, but I'm happy to say it now, proud to say it now.
It makes me want to... I've never bought poppies.
Yeah.
Because I think, in a way, part of what the poppy thing is about celebrating warfare.
Yes,
and I
agree.
Don't like that.
I don't wear one either.
But this story makes me want to wear the poppy to celebrate what they're now saying.
We'll wear one together this year coming. We'll know why.
We'll make some pink ones.
We will. That's a good idea.
Oh, this is a horrible story, sadly. Yeah. The Metropolitan Police are on the hunt for four men involved in the homophobic attack of two victims. Now, I saw this on the news and I saw it on the BBC's website and I was absolutely horrified, because clearly in the video captures that they have, you can see who these people are.
Yeah,
so how long does it take to haul them in?
They need to have a sort of crime watch programme, don't they, so that we can... I mean, I don't know why they got rid of it. It was a great programme. But I'm sure Nick Ross would round them up before too long. So, we need to get them on TV a lot, these people, and find out who they are and obviously prosecute them. It's appalling what they did. Everybody thinks that, I think. There's hardly anyone who doesn't think that anymore. So that's good. But let's find them and lock them up. Yep.
Now, the strange thing is, we've talked earlier in yesterday's programme about the fact that young people are far more accepting and far more understanding and far more open-minded. But these are young people.
Mm. There are still a lot of people who basically use the word gay in not the right way. You know, there's a lot of young people who use it as a basically swear word, really, isn't it, basically? You know, and that, I think that's very common in football clubs and football dressing rooms. Why don't we have any Premier League footballers coming out? Because maybe the word gay is thrown around
too
much.
Can't be gay in a footballer, Bill.
Exactly.
Did you not know this?
Yeah, that's what I mean. So that is one thing that really needs to change. We need to see some footballers at major clubs, Arsenal, Man U, Liverpool, Brighton, Seagulls. They need to come out and they need to face the flak. They'll be loved by everyone if they do.
They become national heroes.
They will become national heroes. They will have to face a lot of people.
They have a role model to look up to. Justin Fashanu did it.
He did it
a long time ago. And he wasn't reviled. He was revered for taking that action.
And in other sports, people like Tom Daley have really shown the way. So, that needs to happen. But as you can see, homophobic attacks have not gone away. They are still massive. Hate crime is still... you know, big thing, and since the Brexit thing started, it's got a heck of a lot worse.
It has. I think also it's interesting that this took place not in a ghetto, not in a dark back street. This took place on the South Bank by the Oxo Tower. Floodlit, busy, a popular place for people to go for entertainment and leisure. Mm-hmm. And these guys attacked two young men who were just holding hands.
Mm. There's still an awful lot of homophobia about all over the UK. Mm-hmm. We've got people, you know, on TV, media like myself, and that saying it's a lot of progress, but maybe not so much progress in, you know, some areas of the UK, you know, so we can't be complacent. We've got to keep fighting.
It's not over, is it?
It's not over, absolutely.
It really isn't. And I think you're right,
just started,
saying
really,
that, you know, in the last 2 years there has been an increase in hate crime.
Yeah.
One of the statistics, though, that could sway this is that people are far more ready to report.
They are.
And far more willing
absolutely
to report.
Yeah.
So we could be seeing a fluctuation in those statistics because we are all feeling happier about saying, I was attacked, I was abused, and all of these things. And I think that's really important. I know when I was younger and I was attacked and beaten up, on more than one occasion, on more than three occasions.
Yeah.
And it was only the third time that I actually went to the police. And part of it was fear of the police not giving a damn. Mm. And part of it was shame.
Yeah.
And embarrassment about having been attacked and not being able to defend myself. Because, you know, when I was in my 20s, I was hardly the most strapping of males. No. You know.
I've been attacked a few times in my life too, you know, for being a bit different, for being a bit weird, you know. Yeah. And there's still a lot of people in the UK who just don't like that. They don't like any diversity, you know, not necessarily gay, but any sort of thing. You wear a green hat and people don't like you and will beat you up, you know.
Yeah.
The far right, you know, in the last 2 years, they're not known for being progressives. You know, I don't think the SS, you know, Hitler's SS.
It's not getting better. Remember that you have to, not just enough to come out, you have to shout out. Let's go to a break. We'll see you after these ads. Hello and welcome back to Queersay with me, Andrew Kay, and my guest this week, Bill Smith. Another good news story. I seem to have picked quite a lot of good news stories for you this week.
Good.
It's important, actually, that I managed to find so many good news stories, because some weeks when I'm doing my trawl through the world's media, I can't find anything positive to say. But this is great. This is that the LGBT plus youth group, All Sorts Youth Project, are expanding their services to Worthing and beyond. And that's really, really good news. Now, we know All Sorts well here in the city. It's an incredible organisation. It's been going for a long time now, and they are very positively out there looking after young people who are coming out as being gay, bi, trans, whatever, and doing very, very important work, often with very limited funds.
Yeah, it must be very hard still in this world, in this county, you know, in places like Worthing, Chichester, Horsham, Eastbourne. Must be very hard to come out because you haven't got a supportive groupings really around you that are very public. In Brighton we've got loads of public groupings. We've got a whole street, you know, just behind us, St James Street, full of gay bars, gay clubs, you know, you name it. That doesn't happen in other places, so you do feel you're much more of a minority in places like Worthing. There should be a sort of St James Street in Worthing. Let's try and persuade a few people to start a few things like that too.
Well, there is quite a strong gay community over in Worthing.
Is there?
And this is partly because of a change in the way gay people perceive moving forward with their personal lives, in that gay people in the last 10, 15 years have decided that actually we want the rights to have families.
Yeah.
And once you've decided that, Brighton being expensive as a place to live and certainly to buy, Worthing became a very strong option. And I know a lot of people who have decided to take the route of becoming parents and moved there because schools are good and property is cheaper.
And pubs where you can hold hands if you're gay and stuff.
The infrastructure in that level hasn't been there.
Yeah, that's what we need to change.
And I think that's really important.
Need to be publicly able to walk down the street and hold hands with your love.
Yeah.
That's it.
I think, you know,
well done All Sorts, though, for getting out there and getting this happening. It's very late coming, you know. It should have been 25 years ago. I'm sure they've been campaigning for it for a long time. So West Sussex Council, not always the most progressive of councils, you know, far from it in many cases. So well done that All Sorts have persuaded them to back such an important thing.
I think it's massive news.
You know what it's like coming out in a place that's not very LGBT friendly.
Well, I grew up in a very small village outside a small town outside Liverpool.
You weren't shouting it out, were you, basically?
No, I suppose, in a sense, I was reasonably flamboyantly
probably the same
gay
as places in West Sussex. You were, I know, yeah. I've seen the pictures.
I know that when I came to London, I actually went to art school and went back in for a little while.
Yeah.
Because it was very focused and very sort of driven by...
What's your take on people, you know, Chichester and Worthing and that then? How easy would it be for them to come out?
I think it's very difficult, almost all the way across the country. And I think it's just as difficult in Brighton, even though the support structures are there.
Okay.
It's not...
Yeah.
The support structures, once you've decided you're going to do it, are important, and it's great once you've decided to do it. But that initial move from being in the closet to out of the closet is massive.
And all sorts, very
all
important.
Sorts doing a brilliant job.
Yeah.
And good luck to them, and I hope they receive the appropriate funding that they need to make this work.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think it's an organisation that should be actually national and across the country, all sorts.
There isn't really
exist.
One, is there? It's all very local.
There are all sorts
I
of
think
things.
That's good that it's local, but maybe you're right, yeah. Mm. Yeah, maybe.
Let's move on. Sad news, and it's been out of the news for a little while. There was a time on Queersay where we couldn't do an episode without talking about Chechnya. It's gone quiet, but now it's rearing its head again, and there's a report of a new gay purge, which is just terrifying.
Well, the president a while back said he wanted to get rid, exterminate, or some word like that, wasn't it?
Well, he made this wonderful
statement. He wanted to get rid of the whole community.
He wanted to get rid of all gay people.
That's right, yeah.
But in a similar statement, at the same time, he also said, of course, there are no gay people in Chechnya.
Yeah, because I've got rid of them already.
Because, well, total denial, there's no such thing as a gay Russian.
No.
Or a gay Chechenian.
Yeah.
But we're going to get rid of them.
If there are any, yeah.
Which is it's muddled thinking, to say the least.
Well, it just shows, you know, that exactly what we were saying, but that sort of extreme homophobia and caused by either very, very religious organisations or very, very right-wing organisations.
Or a combination of very right-wing religious organisations.
Yeah, which you're seeing in Chechnya and Hungary and in Lithuania, even across Eastern Europe, but not just Eastern Europe, China. I mean, I could go around the world and list 50 countries, you know.
So there are about 50 countries where it is still punishable, not just by prison, but in some places by sentence of death.
It's just appalling, really, and it's, as you say, a sad story, and it's it's come to light the last few weeks. Must be a few journalists there reporting to the national press here.
I think it's very difficult for them to actually report.
Yeah.
The thing that terrifies me about this whole report is the word hunted.
Mm.
It's not that... If someone emerges or if someone says I'm out or something like that, they're actually hunting. And the word hunting to me is terrifying.
Yeah.
They're tracking down and then taking to these camps.
It's really what happened, you know, to the Jewish community in, you know, Warsaw and the like. You know, they were hunted, you know, by the Hitler's bunch in the...
Yeah.
Then and hunting is... Yeah, just the word that they used. In fact, there's some horrifying films about, you know, you see them with the dogs and that, and they are hunting
Absolutely
people.
Absolutely hunting.
And, yeah, to see that brought back, you know, for any community is wrong. We just seem to never really learn. Humanity makes you wonder.
I'd like to finish on something that's funny.
Okay, good.
Having that story, which is very important... bisexual porn star reveals why he only wants to film gay porn scenes.
Ah, interesting.
Well,
yeah.
You know, good for you.
Wow, yeah.
I have to say...
Why?
I can't help thinking that this may be fake news and that this is a porn star and his company wanting to gain publicity for the work that he's doing.
Seems to work.
Do you call it work?
I probably would, yeah. You know, I mean, I think it is work, but I mean, I'm interested to know why. I don't know anything about the story. It's quite good that he could probably do both before. I mean, that's quite liberal, isn't it? But I suppose in a sort of... very bizarre way, that's liberal.
He's called Blake Mitchell, and he said some really things. I didn't want to be part of the straight industry because of how it can be operated sometimes.
Yeah.
The gay industry can be seedy sometimes, but pretty much all of the straight industry is seen as seedy by the performers.
Right.
It's interesting. I didn't realise there was a sort of collective of gay porn stars. Is there a union?
It must be. I mean, I think the whole sort of, you know, porn industry is fairly sleazy all around, you know. I remember actually meeting someone on who came to work here a fair few years ago, young woman. She was an intelligent journalist, I thought, and I asked her what she really wanted to do in life, and she said, oh, I would like to be a porn star, and she said it with a straight face, like it was a real career, and it took me back for a minute or two, thinking, blimey, how could she say that, as if it was... If she just said it as if it was like, you know, I want to be a bus driver, or I want to be a... You know, she said, oh, I want to be a porn star, Bill.
It was one of my ambitions when I graduated from Chelsea as a graphic designer. I did really want to be art director on one of the major porn magazines.
You did.
But something like
for
Club,
all the right reasons,
Club International. Because at the time,
yeah,
those magazines were incredibly slick,
yes,
incredibly rich, and yeah, also commissioning really good writing.
Mm.
You know, and it wasn't the hard end of the porn industry, it was the soft end of the porn industry.
Yeah.
But it was the lure of the fact that they had the money to do a job really, really well. And that was very appealing.
I
think the porn industry has changed an awful lot now, of course, because the internet has turned it into a multi-billion pound industry.
Yeah, everything that happens on the internet is first of all tested basically on porn sites, isn't it? All the best inventions, the social media stuff, all really came from those things. So, I mean, I'm in two minds about it. I don't want to stop anyone doing what they want to do. That's my key thing in
life.
What
was your first experience of pornography, Bill?
My first experience of pornography, God, it would be magazines.
I think it's probably the same ones that I had wafted in front of my face. One was called Parade.
Yes.
And one was called Fiesta.
And I do remember both of them, yeah.
And they were sort of...
I don't really remember them, but I remember the names and I've seen them. But yeah, I think it would have been those magazines for sure. Yeah, when I was, you know,
and
teenage.
Compared to the manifestation of pornography these days, they were incredibly
well. You see it everywhere now, don't you? I mean, you can't really avoid it on phones, on TV, everywhere. And we were talking earlier, weren't we, about whether the sexuality or the sexualization of young people. Yeah, and I mean, I'm in two minds about that. I don't think it's right that 8-year-old, you know, girls should dress up like Rihanna and, you know, whatever they do.
Yeah,
you know,
I'm with you on that.
Yeah.
Sadly, we've run out of time.
Okay.
Do
great
come
fun.
Back. Come back in 5 weeks.
Okay. Thank
you. We'll talk again. I'll drag some more stories out for you.
Okay. Great.
It's really been interesting today having someone who isn't on the team talking about the issues that affect the team. And it's also great that to know that I have someone on that side of the fence supporting us. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll see you in a week's time for two more episodes of Queersay, but for now, it's good night. Good night.